in the meditation of my heart. Get something on thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. The Lord said,
Amen.
Amen. Amen. What happened to be with a group of folks a long, long time? I've been listening to folks for a long time. They didn't know how to stir you up.
Yeah.
And they didn't know how to get the spirit moving. And may he permeate everyone here and even those that are listening to social media. From the gospel according to Luke, chapter 14, starting at verse 15 and reading through verse 24. Luke 14, starting at verse 15 and reading through verse 24 from the original King James text. And it reads as follows. And when one of them that sat at meat with him heard these things, he said unto him, blessed is he that shall eat bread in the kingdom of God. Then said he unto him, a certain man made a great supper and bade many. He invited many. And he sent his servant at supper time to say to them that were bidden, come, for all things are now ready. And they all with one consent began to make excuse. First said unto him, I have bought a piece of ground, and I must needs go and see it. I pray thee, have me excused. At least he was polite about it. Another said, I have bought 5 yoke of oxen, and I go to prove them. I pray thee, have me excused. And another said, I have married a wife, and therefore I cannot come. He goes, where's he gone? So that servant came and showed his Lord these things. Then the master of the house, being angry, said to his servant, go out quickly into the streets and the lanes of the city, and bring in hither the poor, and the maimed, and the halt, and the blind. And the servant said, Lord, it is done as thou hast commanded, and yet there is room. The Lord said unto the servant, go out into the highways and hedges and compel them to come in, that my house may be filled. For I say unto you, that none of those men which were bidden shall taste of my supper. Thank you, let me see it.
Hallelujah.
Put these verses in mind and perhaps other passages of scripture that the Lord gives us, his spirit gives us utterance. I want to focus on verse 15 as our spotlight verse. And when one of them sat at meat with him, heard these things, he said unto him, blessed is he that shall eat bread in the kingdom of God. And I'm going to talk very briefly this morning on the subject, blessed now and forever. This man in the text is speaking about being blessed in the future. But I stopped by to tell you today how to be blessed now and forever. Not just when we leave this earth, but blessed while we're here on earth, both now and forever. If you have studied this text in the past, I'm sure you are familiar with it. We know that this incident takes place at the house of a rich man. And he was a chief of the Pharisees, the scripture tells us. And tension began to fill the room as the moment Jesus walked into the room. The Bible says that they were watching him. They were watching him because it was on the Sabbath. And they had already placed a man in there with an ailment. So they were watching Jesus to see what he's going to do. It's something about a child of God. When you enter certain settings, there's somebody watching you carefully just to see what you're going to do. They want to know if your behavior will be consistent with Christian character. Of course, Jesus healed the man, but before he did, he asked him a question. Is it lawful, according to your laws, if you understand them, is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath? And they didn't answer. You know how we are. If you ask yourself, you don't say nothing, that means it's okay. He went ahead and healed the man. And then he reminded them of their law. You will pull a donkey out the well on the Sabbath, but you won't put a human being out. So they all automatically were beginning to get some tension toward him. Then he went on to watch them as they all hurried in to get the seat of honor. And then he corrected them on that as well. He said, why are you all rushing up there to get the best seat? What if he invited somebody more important than you?
Come on,
then you got to come up there in front of everybody and ask you to get up out of this seat and give to somebody else. Then you got to go in shame back to another seat. He said, but he that exalted himself, you know, when you're all about yourself, you want them to look at you and what you have. Look at you and what you've done. Look at you and your time. You exalt yourself, but he that exalted himself shall be a baby. But he that humble shall be exalted. If you do these things so that folks can look at you and know what you used to be and see something better and different about you, then they look at Jesus. When you humble yourself, and he said you'd be exalted. He didn't stop there. He said something to the man in the house too. Why don't you just invite the rich folk and your kinfolk and your friends? How come you don't invite the lame and the poor, you know, the crippled?
Yeah.
And then you will be blessed in the resurrection of the righteous. So the tension got real high in. And that's when one of those Pharisees said at the table, said, let me ease the tension. Verse 15. And when one of them that sat at meat with him heard these things, he said unto him, blessed is he that shall eat bread in the kingdom of God, assuming to himself and his friend that they were going to be the ones that were going to be there. Because of the fact that they were blessed at that moment in time. And there's a lot of present day folks who say they're Christians have the same mindset as this man. They look very religious. They obey the law. They have people on the outside be very religious, but their hearts were far from God. Because they look down over the people who are creatures of God just like they are, and some of y'all got the same attitude. Don't fool yourself just because you're blessed now. Don't assume that you're going to be blessed now. Just because you're religious doesn't mean you're saved.
Preach.
So, he tried to ease the tension by saying, blessed is he that shall eat bread in the kingdom of God. Well, you see, as in most cases, you have to first of all be invited. And they were invited. But let's deal with this word, what blessed for a while. I want you to see what it really means to be blessed. You will come back and walk through this parable in a few minutes and I'll be at your way. First of all, this Pharisee, no other religious leader present, and so many people today had the wrong concept of the life of a Christian. They think that to be a Christian, your life must be a life of sorrow. You see, there's a great misunderstanding of what Jesus said when he was speaking to his disciples in Matthew 5, and what is known as the Beatitudes. He said, blessed are they that mourn.
That's right.
And he meant that. Blessed are they that mourn. But in our present day society, even before COVID, we had to begin to separate from one another. We don't even mourn folk like we used to. I'm always mindful, and I hope others are, when they are preaching and speaking over folk who have gone home. I just watch folks, and some of them act like this never going to happen again. Whatever you're saying to that family, you better be saying to yourself. You got to cross your too. Because Jesus says, blessed are they that mourn, that we're supposed to walk around mourning all the time. And some folk mind, you're not saying that you're mourning. And there are some things we ought to mourn over. Yes, this sorrow that we do mourn over is not due to Christ, because we know that Jesus came into the world to impart joy unto us. What did the songwriter say on the and talking about his birth? Joy to the world. The Lord is born. So he came to bring us joy. Our sorrow then is the product of our sin.
All right.
God spoke these words, not just all sin. Sin was here. Sin was here when we got here.
Yes,
David said we're born in sin, shaping iniquity. Yes, but the Bible says God spoke to his people in the Garden of Eden. He said, I will greatly, after sin came in, I will greatly multiply thy sorrow. I will greatly multiply thy sorrow because you chose to disobey me. Mm-hmm. Sorrow is a consequence of man's choice to disobey. So when we willfully choose to disobey God, you might as well get ready, because there will always be consequences. Faith in Jesus Christ, true faith, saving faith in Jesus Christ by God's grace takes the penalty away. But when we willfully sin, we will face and endure consequences for our actions. That's where the sorrow and the mourning comes in. It is necessary that we mourn before we can rejoice. We have to acknowledge the fact that we have missed the mark, fell short of God's glory, and repent. And then, having mourned of our sins, then we can truly rejoice.
Yes, sir.
Because we ought to learn from our mistakes.
Amen.
So then the blessed person, this man thought he was one, but he wasn't in verse 15. The blessed person is the person who mourns for his sin.
All right.
Too many of us, we are miserable Christians because we are mourning over everybody else's misconduct, everybody else's thoughts and failures, but our own. So we're so saintly and pious, but we're miserable because we're mourning over everybody else's sin. And not mourning over our own sins. When we recognize what sin has done to this world, it's something new and drastic, and it seems to get worse day by day. When we recognize what sin has done to this world and to us, we can't help but mourn.
Amen. All right.
I hate to put the little news tag on my phone, not God knows. Not just one, but the first six bars on each side of one catastrophe after another.
Amen.
And so we mourn. It is not out of mourning. It is out of the mourning, I say, for our sins that this blessedness is born. We recognize the fact that we are sinners and have sin, but God loves us. And when we confess our sin and repent, then we move into an area of blessedness.
All right.
Joy.
Joy.
I'm talking about true joy. Kind of we shout about sometime at the end of the sermon. Comes in and through the Lord Jesus Christ.
All right.
You know, the joy is temporary. You like the man sitting at the table talking about what you're going to do in the kingdom when you already have declined the invitation. The blessing you got is down here is all the blessing you're going to get. It's a dangerous thing to turn down the Lord's invitation. The Lord Jesus, in the Beatitudes in Matthew chapter 5, 1 through 11, he called his disciples blessed. They were blessed because the word that Jesus used for blessed means to be possessed with God's nature as a result of what Jesus Christ has done. See, he knew what he was going to do for them, even that they would need it. So they were blessed because they would be possessed. We are blessed when we truly believe in Jesus Christ and have received a new birth. God's spirit, God's nature replaces our old spirit. Yes, we have now have been possessed by God because of our faith in what Jesus. That's why he told Nicodemus, you must be born again.
Yes, sir.
The Lord Jesus makes it plain in the scriptures that we are blessed because of him. Mm-hmm. us first. And we say we love him.
Yes.
So then, if we love him, why don't we obey him? If we love him, why don't we trust him? If we love him, why don't we praise him publicly? If we love him, why don't we tell him thank you?
Thank you.
The same blessedness that the Lord Jesus spoke to his disciples about can be applied to our lives. When we endure the things that he spoke about, he said, when we endure these things for the Son of Man's sake. Remember at the end of it, he said, blessed are you when you go through all these things for the Son of Man's sake. Not for your own advancement, not for your own building up of yourself, but it's for the Son of Man's sake.
All right.
When they humiliate you for prideful acts, you get to just you. But when they humiliate you for standing up for the right, when everybody else is being guided by the wrong, then it's for the Son of Man's sake. And then you're truly blessed. Mm-hmm. It is because of who the Lord Jesus Christ is and what he has done that we can become the same thing God is, and that is blessed. Listen, and I had to learn this by experience. Blessedness is an inner condition, which is unaffected, Joe, by outside circumstances that are beyond our control.
All right.
The whole world can be falling down around a Christian, the bottom can drop out. But there's this inner joy, this inner peace, this joy that I have. The world didn't give it to me. The world didn't give it. And the world can't take it away. It's an inner feeling, mm-hmm, which is unaffected by outside circumstances that are beyond our control. You see, you've got to really know the God that you serve. The only way you can know him is through true faith in his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And when you come to know him, you'll have this inner peace. This inner joy, this inner power, that's not affected by outside circumstances from which we have no control. In fact, I'm better off if they get beyond my control.
Thank you, Jesus.
I'm better off. They've been saying for years, he owned his head. Yeah, I'm on my head. I should have died a long time ago. I may be over my head, but there ain't no mess in my head, and you can
tell me.
There's foolishness in my head. Because I got an inner presence that's not affected by outside circumstances. In other words, I know that at the end of the day, God is still in control. You see, he brought me through too many things. He brought me from way back. So much with the man who sees out there. He's done too much for me. I see too much now to be talking about what's going on the outside, but I got God on the inside.
He's a
providential God.
Yeah.
You see, he's in control all the time of what's going on. Right. Even when we don't understand. But not only that, he's a miraculous God. He's a miracle working God. He is down there. He controls everything. But when things seem like they're going contrary to nothing, he can stop it. He can overrule nature. He can overrule the normal course that we get to bring about his kingdom to a purpose. That's all a miracle. Know what a miracle look like? They can look at me.
Amen.
They said I wouldn't make it. They said I wouldn't be here today. Some of them won't even be at the feast. And I'm still working. You see, that's why there are so many miserable Christians today. You see, circumstances may bring temporary happiness and joy. But the indwelling spirit of God, the God of Jesus Christ, is who brings blessing. That's who brings blessing. Should we get happiness mixed up with blessings? You got to know God. I got to keep emphasizing that. If you don't, you'll be deceived. You can easily be like these folk in the text. fall so much in love with the things of this world. As the parable reveals, that you forget who really loves you.
Right.
And where it all came from.
Say it.
He just invited them to a feast.
Uh-huh.
All I do is show up.
Show up. Just show up.
Let me stop right here and say this. I'm going to get through with this. I'm not talking about anybody. Let me just say it plain. I'm not talking about nobody. I'm just talking about what I'm talking about. So if it happened to hit you, I'm going to get it. Just consider the totality of the sermon. You like that joke? Before you get too mad, let me consider the totality of the sermon. Because I want you to leave here blessed, not just here, but forever. This state of blessedness is not deferred to the world to come only at the future, but it begins right here and now. It is equivalent to the kingdom of God. This is one of the attitudes. Whenever they have the promise of the kingdom of heaven, it is stated in the past tense. The kingdom has come.
Yes.
Came when Jesus came.
All right.
There are future rewards, don't get me wrong, for present obedience. But the state of blessedness begins here and now. It is the word blessing that caused Jesus to speak this parable about the great sower.
All right.
He said, now I talked to him about healing on the Sabbath. I talked to him about trying to get the high seat. I talked to him about inviting all the rich buddies. He said, but now they still think they're blessed. They still don't have the right understanding of this word, blessedness. So the Bible says this Pharisee made a statement. Blessed is he that shall eat bread in the kingdom of God.
Uh-huh.
He was right about the statement now.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. What he was wrong about is that unless he repented, it didn't apply to him. But not only that, it didn't apply to anybody else in the room. Jesus was the only saved person in the room at that point in time.
All right.
But he came. He came. Just like he came into our life. To extend an invitation. This man was speaking of a future event that he assumed that he would be present in. The concept of the Jews and the Greek was that at some time in the future, God will make possible this state of blessedness. The Pharisee said, paraphrasing what he said, he who will eat bread in the kingdom of God at some time in the future will experience the joy of blessedness, the joy that comes from God. He had it right, except for it didn't apply to him at that point in time. Because the thing that Jesus is pointing out, and I'm pointing out to you, Jesus said, now you're looking down the road, but the feast is ready now.
All right.
The feast is here. The feast is present. And guess what? You are invited. Jesus spoke in the past tense. He said, a certain man made a great supper.
Yes, sir.
In other words, the supper had already been prepared.
All right. All right.
And the invitations had already been sent out.
Uh-huh.
To get the full meaning of what happened in this story, you have to understand Jewish culture.
All right.
The big wheels. The Pharisees and the leaders and such as that, whenever they were invited to a banquet or some big event like that, they received two invitations.
All right.
They would get the invitation announcing the date and time of the event so that they can do like some of us do, go ahead on and put it on your calendar.
Yeah.
And then again, on the day of the event, the host would send his servant out to tell them, you know, today is the day of the banquet, the time to come on. And the custom was that if they didn't get that second invitation, there wasn't no show. So y'all still with me?
Yes, sir.
Let us go back and talk scripture for a minute. The Lord sent the first invitation to Israel with the prophets. And they said they would accept it. But it was just like the man sitting at the table, it was all talk. It was all religious talk. They said they would accept it with their mouth, but their hearts were far from God. Because the fact of the matter is, they didn't want to go to the best way. Like so many folks today, they talk a good game. But when the rubber hit the road, they don't want any part of what God has prepared.
Amen.
That you enraptured and enamored what they have here and now. So many folks living for the here and the now. And even the aging process ought to warn us that there is a feast ahead. The only way that you can be present at the feast, you must accept the invitation. I said the first invitation came through the prophets. If you read Mark's gospel, the second invitation came through God's Son, who is also God's holy servant.
All right.
He shows up in the midst of all these mean-hearted folk to teach them the ways of God.
Yeah.
But like so many folk today, they didn't want any part of it. Can I get a witness?
Yes.
Jesus came and said the kingdom is here now that God offered through the prophets. And now you can come. He even warned them when he talked to the host, how come you invite all these worldly folk? Why come you won't invite some maimed, some poor, crippled, blind, lame? And then let my Father reward you at the resurrection of the righteous. Jesus was trying to tell them, he was telling them, the kingdom that he's speaking of is not something physical, but a state of blessedness. God indwelling man and making man's heart his inner throne. Don't you know if you're really saved that you ought to have received by now the gift of beloved? Sweet. Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Calms you when things get complicated.
Yeah.
Give you courage where you feel like you might have to feel. Heals you. Heals your mind when you're about to get sick. Isn't God all right?
Yeah.
His kingdom, is like bread that must be eaten so that many can be satisfied. It's available, and it is, but it won't do you any good until you eat it. His kingdom is here, but you won't get in until you accept the invitation. And Jesus extended that invitation over and over again as he walked among men, even made it plain one time. Said the same thing. He said, take hope, come unto me, all ye that are weary and heavy laden, and a great feast, and I want everybody to come sit down at the table. Bring the room in my Father's kingdom. And I heard him say that on the day of the event, he sent his sermon at supper time to all who were invited. Come, for all things are ready. Too many of us got the times mixed up. You see, that is chronos, which is man's time. 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, and so on. And then there is chaos, which is God's time. I don't know about you, but too many of us focus so much on chronos, man's time, that we forget all about God's time. And what I want you to know, when God's time comes to move, he moves swiftly. He said, tell him, come, the whole things are not ready, but they're all on one accord, on one consent. They all began to make excuses. Can I get a witness?
Yes.
Come on. The supper ready. Everything is fixed. All you got to do is show up. But they begin to make excuses. What I'm saying, I haven't got my COVID shot yet. They freak. Set up all over town. How come you haven't got your shot? Please excuse me. I bought some land. I got to go and look at it. I bought some land. But land belongs to God. But belongs to you. But I ran in a good book the other day. The earth is the Lord's. And the fullness thereof. The world. And there is a heaven and a hell. And for y'all, that's not what I'm talking about. Some of y'all will do it till God will give you a little money.
Thank you.
Deep in Get up! Bible! Bible! know that's all you require.
Yeah.
So there it is with you.
Yeah.
And we thank you for this time of worship. All the glory, all the worship, all the praise that truly belongs to you. We thank you for this time here with one another. Thank you for the working, the powerful working of your beloved Holy Spirit.
Yes.
Somebody leaving here today knowing that they are blessed, not just now, but they are. We give you glory, Lord. We thank you. And we praise you because the whole because of Jesus, your beloved Son, the Son of the living God, the Savior of the whole world. Thank you, honor us and guide us and keep us as we go from this place back into a new world. Let us go with that light of Christ shining in us. That somebody might look and look at the young what they see on the physical. When they look at us, that they may see Jesus and come to him and be saved. We pray we're going to work while we can.
Yes.
And here, Lord, when it's time to come home, we'll just lay ready for the peace.
Yes.
And wait for that great gift of morning.
Yeah.
And we thank you for your promise, for your promise is sure.
Thank you.
We just, when we go along, we won't come out no more. We just want to wait to hear those welcome words of the God, well done.
Yeah.
Rest from your love and implore the balance, part of the victory is won. Enter the master's joy. Rise up, servant. Get up.
Yes, Lord.
Come on. Let the Lord of you things come up alive. Don't let you rule over men. Do it for us, Lord. We'll be so glad and careful to see that you get all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise for it truly belongs to you. We ask you these things. We believe you, Father. We receive them right now through faith in the Lord Jesus of Nazareth by your grace. Now may the grace and love of God and the sweet communion of his beloved Holy Spirit, may he rest and may he rule and abide in each one of us henceforth, now and forever. Lift every heart and every voice, sing just as loud as you can. Oh! Hallelujah, hallelujah.